I'm impressed that you all came here. Nothing to do with us taking leave to see what we're going to pay if you didn't show up. That's it. I want you to know that this is the seventh, I think, presidential economic summit series we've had. And we've had some great speakers, and tonight we have another one who's really one of our own. And Kurt and I, we were just talking about our paths crossed chronologically. Remember that he was a serious guy and I was. So we're going to talk about ethics tonight. And we know what's going on in the election this year, everything that's happened with Bernie and Hillary, and anybody that's going to vote for Hillary, please leave now. I just want to know one thing she's done, that's all, just one. Okay, anyway, so tonight we're going to talk about ethics. We're going to talk about ethics.
Good man.
This is the way it's going to be tonight. So we want, Kurt is going to ask a lot of questions, he's going to bring up a lot of points, and I'm hoping that you'll come out with some questions of your own, and the more controversial, the better. This is a chance for you to voice your opinions, to hear what's going on in the real world. And I want to thank President Garassi and the trustees and all the assembled guests tonight. Thank you very much for showing up. And of course, most important, you, our students. Okay. That's why we're here. So I'd like to pass it off to President Garassi right now. And thank you very much for allowing me to be around for so long.
We should give a round of applause to Donnie Crooks. That's a great program. So it's my pleasure to introduce Kurt, and I'm going to first read you some of the formal stuff about him so you have a sense of man in front of you and what he's accomplished. As you, many of you may know, he joined the Educational Testing Service. All of you have taken SATs. How many people have taken SATs? Blame him. He started there as a youngster, but then he and then went off to work with DuPont International and was the CEO of DuPont, a pharmaceutical company. And he came back after many, many years with DuPont and came back to revive, really, and resuscitate ETS into a much more vibrant organization that dealt with assessment through all levels of education and beyond education. But some of the things that you don't know about Kurt, and then I want to tell you a story, are his civic commitments are quite strong. He has for a long, long time been involved in social and community work from the corporate side as well as from the personal side. When he was at ETS, he had ETS working very closely with historically black colleges and universities, with the Urban League, with the Hispanic Association of College and Universities, and with ASPRO, the Association of Native American Education Groups. So he really believes in what you're going to hear tonight in terms of corporate responsibility and social responsibility. He was a member of the New Jersey Commission of Higher Education and many, many, many boards, some of which you read probably in the previews to this event, but he is now on the board of directors of ICON, Office Solutions, Louisiana Pacific Corporation, Corning Incorporated. He sits on the National Pharmaceutical Council, the United Way of Delaware, Delaware Association of Rights of Citizens with Mental Retardation, and so many other places, Delaware Cares and the like. He graduated from Wagner in 1968 as an economics major, and he got his honorary doctorate from Wagner in 2008. And we were so privileged to have him as our graduation speaker, and he was one of the most popular graduation speakers we've ever had. But what I really want to tell you is, and he has three master's degrees and a special citation from Harvard Business School for Advanced Management Program and the like. Those are all the formal things, but here's the story that's most interesting. He came to Wagner College on a baseball scholarship. How many baseball players do we have in here? Any baseball players? Maybe I'll point somewhere. I'm not sure. There are a couple. Okay, so here's a fellow alumnus teammate. And he chose Wagner when he came down to a few schools because at Wagner in New York State, the drinking age was 18. And in New Jersey, it was 21. So those critical intellectual choices that he made. But the other last story I'll tell you, and let Kurt take over, was and this is a story that he wrote about quite a bit when he was at ETS. He did these major advertorials, I guess they call them, about ETS and what difference one professor can make in your life. And so when Kurt was an undergraduate here, we had a wonderful economics professor, not to be confused with the television personality, Bill Maher. And he actually went on only to be a wonderful economics professor, very influential in lots of students, but he was also became the treasurer of the school at one point as well. And Bill was the person who really inspired Kurt to take himself quite seriously after his first year. He said, a lot brighter than you think you are, and you really can contribute a lot to the world. And he went on to major in economics, and the rest is history. So without further ado, Kurt Landgraf.
Good evening, everybody. So for those of you who are looking at the program and wonder what happened to the speaker whose picture is on there, that's my high school graduation picture, which I actually refused to give up. So that's actually me. This is what happens when you retire. You lose it on the top, you grow it on the bottom. A couple things I'm going to also tell you is that I'm going to say some things to you that I believe that you don't have to agree with. So I want you to know that I grew up in Newark, New Jersey. Anybody here from Newark? All right. So
Weequake.
Well, I grew up in not such a nice neighborhood. There's nothing you can say to me, and you can use any tone of voice that you want to use that I haven't heard before. Okay? So I really urge you, if you hear something you disagree with, I want to echo what Dr. Cook said. I want you to ask me or tell me that I'm wrong, and we'll talk about that. I'm here to try to, I've been on the board of 5 public companies. I've been on some outstanding boards. And since they're videotaping this, I want you to know that my comments are not reflective of any existing board. But I've been on all kinds of boards. I've been on the board of a pharmaceutical company that went bankrupt. Okay. I've been on the board of phenomenal big companies like Corning. I've been on the board of 5 public companies. I've seen the good, the bad, and the ugly. And I'm going to talk to you about it. And you don't have to agree with anything I'm going to say. And I want you to know I am a Democrat. So I just got cleared up. I ran for governor of Delaware. I lost. I have very strong social opinions, and my son and maybe Bob knows this, but there was an article in Business Week many, many years ago when I was the chief operating officer of the DuPont company. Incidentally, when the DuPont company was like a real company, you can put that on the tape. The article in Business Week was the highest ranking corporate leftist in America. So now you know me. You can now judge my opinions based upon that. Maybe the last thing I'll tell you is my wife is Secretary of Health and Human Services for the state of Delaware. She's even further Okay, so I'm not exactly sure why Dr. Garassi and Dr. Crooks invited me, but I'm here. And so I do want to talk to you. This is a great honor. Thank you. So I know that you're all paying attention. And you know, since the year 2008, which is the great financial crisis, and looking at the age of some of you here, that was like when you were in junior high school. But the world changed in 2008. Corporations, large and small, not just banks, have come under extraordinary criticism. Some of it intense, some of it really unfair. Lots of increased regulation, and for those of you who been paying any attention to the current primaries, massive political attacks. And while I'd like to talk to you about that and what causes that. So first I need to tell you, so I wore this so that I could be a professional speaker. So now I'm going to tell you an opinion, but it's a strongly held opinion. America is based upon 3 foundational systems. The first is capitalism. Who can tell me what capitalism is? Come on. Gotta be a student to answer this. Big special prize if you answer it. Yes, ma'am.
An economic system that focuses on free trade and fair market.
And what? And anything else?
Those are specifically what come to mind for me.
Okay, well, you're right, but there's one other thing. and that is capitalism is based upon the premise that the holders of capital are entitled to a return. You need to keep that in mind. The second is democracy. Democracy is the second foundation of America. See, the students writing this down. It's not going to be on the test, I promise you. And the third is the Constitution and the Bill of Rights. I believe that all three of those foundational systems are under massive attack. If you do not believe me, turn on the television. All three of those systems are not just capitalism. Democracy is under attack. It is, folks. It's almost embarrassing. It is under attack. I lived in Europe for almost 10 years. If you have European friends, ask them what they think about the United States primary elections and a couple of the current candidates. And I also remind you that on the Democratic side, we have a person who publicly says he is a Democratic socialist running for the presidency of the United States. And the Constitution is under attack. And the Bill of Rights are under attack. So why is that? Well, it's because my belief is this, folks. Unfair, discriminatory, irrational, illegal, inappropriate behavior or outcomes in any of the three, capitalism, democracy, Constitution, Bill of Rights, will impact America deeply. Now let's talk about capitalism and the role of corporations, and then I'm going to talk about what board of directors do to make this work. So capitalism is built on the premise that those with capital are entitled to a return. How many of you agree with that? I'm gonna make this interactive, I promise you. Come on. So you think that capitalism is not, all right? There was three students who said that. That's good. All right, corporate boards are responsible to act in the fiduciary best interests of the company. Fiduciary best interest of the company. Not any specific constituency within the company, not even the shareholders. They are charged with the fiduciary best interest of the company. They're responsible for the use of the corporate power, which is tremendous, for appropriate pursuit and lack of conflict of interest. And they are most importantly responsible to exercise what's called duty of care. What does that mean? You know what that means? What does it mean if a corporate board says you're responsible, as a board member, you are responsible for duty of care? I'll tell you. So I was at ETS for a long time, so I like these tests. So answer A is correct. Duty of care means that you are responsible to protect the interest of all the shareholders of the company, all the constituents. Now, corporations are responsible to shareholders for, now listen to this, performance, not results. Performance is different than results. Corporations are responsible to the shareholders for performance, not at all costs. They're responsible for performance, but not at all costs. And if there's a fundamental area that I've watched boards go wrong, is their narrow interest is in shareholder return and stock price. Why is that, folks? How many of you have a pension fund? How many of you own stock? Yeah, well, if you don't now, you will. So if you want to know who's to blame for the inappropriate behavior of corporations, everybody should look in the, everyone who owns stock or has a pension fund should look in the mirror. Here's what I believe. The mistake that is made is that boards believe that they are responsible to only one constituency, shareholders, stock price, quarter to quarter. I believe that there are other shareholders that we are, have greater responsibility to. Your employees, the society we live in, communities, and the very democracy and constitution upon which America is built. So let's look at some, so would you say that all boards do a great job?
No.
Uh-huh. Been paying attention to what's going on at Pfizer? Anybody here work at Pfizer? Anybody here know anybody at Pfizer? Okay, so good, I can say whatever I want. Okay, so let me tell you what's happening at Pfizer. Oh, you know, okay. All right, so Pfizer board decided that they were going to invert by a company called Allergan, which is headquartered in Ireland, and they were going to move their corporate headquarters to Ireland to save taxes. Incidentally, just so we're clear, why did they want to do that?
Save taxes.
Because the corporate tax in America is obscenely high. So I get that fact. But listen to me, folks. If you're watching TV and listening to the primaries and hearing what this current administration has to say about corporate tax avoidance, do you think that the Pfizer board should have been surprised that the Secretary of the Treasury decided to void the transaction? I mean, folks, there are kids in junior high school who would have predicted this outcome. I mean, it isn't like it's been a secret, but the Pfizer board did it anyway. Is that because they're bad? Is that because they're dumb? No. It's because they are tone deaf to the environment around them. So you know they ended up paying $268 million as a breakup fee. So let's talk a little bit about some problem areas that I've seen in board structures. So the composition and the balance of the board in terms of diversity is now and has been a terrific problem. So now I'm going to ask you a question. How are boards selected? Come on, I want a student to answer me. Not how are boards elected. I know how they're elected. How are boards selected? Yes, ma'am.
From top management teams within the company already in place.
Yeah, that's it. You say that. Can you say that louder, Sophie?
From top management teams that are already in place of the company.
Right. Wow. That's, yes, ma'am.
I think very often by the CEO.
That's exactly right. So it's top management. Other board members select incoming board candidates. Most people, when I ask that question, you know the answer I get? They're elected by the shareholders. That's true. They are elected by the shareholders, but they're selected by the top management, often the CEO, and the more of a rock star the CEO is, the higher probability that they will have complete control of the selection process. Now, I know this will come as a tremendous shock to you, but when people self-select for colleagues on a board, what do you think that they're likely to do? Go out and say, let's get some people who really come in here and kick some butt and take some names and really cause us a problem on a quarterly basis. I'm glad you laughed, because they don't. What do they do? Well, I'll tell you what they do, because I've been there. Not on existing boards that I'm on, but I they select people who look like, act like, and behave in a way consistent with the corporate culture. Now, folks, sometimes that works great. It does. It's a good board, a and a good corporate culture and a good management team, and they care about society and they care about democracy and they care about all the constituents, things work great. When doesn't it work great? Generally, when the management is inept, views the board as a necessary evil, hides things from the board, and the boards generally do not take an interventionist policy. So you know, in America, folks, there's a difference in corporate boards than in Europe. In Europe, most boards do not have the chairman, president, and CEO. The chairman is an outside, independent director. In America, most boards have the, and if this, this becomes a macho ego thing, I've been there. Try to say to a phenomenal CEO, we don't think you should be the chairman, president, and CEO. And I've seen them threaten to resign. Because for them, it's a mark of ineptitude. When I would suggest to you folks, a check and balance should be, what do corporate boards in America have? What does a corporate board have? Who leads the board when they go into executive session, do you know? There's a lead, no, the chairman leads the board meeting, but then there are private meetings, and there's a thing called a lead director. Right, the lead director is responsible, quite frankly, for handling the board interactions in private session. So one of the things I'd ask you to look at as you think about boards, look at the composition. Are these people who all grew up with each other in junior high school at 55? When you look in the proxy statement, you ever look at the proxy statements you get? Look what they look like. Look to see what the gender is. Look for how many faces are in that proxy statement that are not white. Look for diversity on the board, because diversity brings greater outcomes. I suggest to you that truly great companies are not afraid of diversity, they embrace it. The second thing that you want to look at is remuneration of the board. How are boards paid? How are boards paid?
Fees.
They get fees. Board fees. What else they get?
Stock.
Stock. Anything else? Options. Fees. Boards get fees. They get stock. And they get options. So let's just say, even if you're a phenomenal director, care about all kinds of social things, but you're being compensated on the basis of short-term option growth, what will you concentrate on? I promise you I'm going to get you to answer. If I'm being compensated on the option growth, what do I concentrate on? The stock price. The stock price. And the stock price in the short term is often very, sorry to get emotional about this, but I'm telling you, it's what's wrong with why we get so much criticism. Concentration on quarter-to-quarter-to-quarter stock price is the bane of American capitalism. It is wrong. Why? Because Kurt says, no, why? Dr. Cook says, why is it wrong?
You can't have a long-term strategy.
You don't, that's exactly right. Is that you stop concentrating on the long-term growth strategy and you concentrate on this quarter's earnings. For those of you who make a mistake and watch CNBC by mistake, you ever watch it? Alcoa announced tonight. I didn't even see how they did. You see? You need to let him watch a little TV, a little CNBC. So I don't know how they did, but I guarantee you that the CEO of Alcoa was on TV tonight. And I don't know whether he missed it by a penny or he made it by a penny, but I will tell you, if he missed it by a penny a share, and he probably has a billion shares outstanding, he misses it by a penny, and it misses it against what?
Projection.
What does he miss it against?
Projection.
Forecast.
Who projects it, Rob?
Analysts.
The analysts. Wall Street analysts project it. They get guidance, but they project it. So they may say Alcoa is going to make 32 cents a share. That's their guess. For those of you who are about to go into Wall Street, you'll know that many Wall Street analysts, I remember when I was the CFO of DuPont, I was always astounded, because when I would go to an analyst meeting, I thought I had wandered into a junior high school. They're all 11. And they all know everything. So these are the people who make the projections. So they project 32 cents a share. Alcoa comes in, it's 31 cents a share. Stock price falls precipitously. Shareholders are unhappy. CEO starts to worry about what? His or her job. So remuneration of the board, you want to look at that. Am I compensated as a board member for short term or long term? So I'm going to tell you a good case of long term. So I'm on the Corning board. You all know Corning? Mm-hmm. Corning, New York, great company. Mm-hmm. It is real. We are compensated entirely in fees. But here's the interesting thing. We're not allowed to take the money until we retire. So my son is in the audience. So Sean, I want to congratulate you, because that will be yours. Why is that a good thing? I mean, you know why it's a good thing for Sean. But why is it a good thing? Because it causes me not, and there are other board members, to not pay so much attention to the short term, because I ain't getting it anyway. What I'm going to get is what happens when I'm 72 when I retire. So you think long term, and they keep people on the board. So remuneration of the board is very important to look at. And I would say a lot of the things that you hear people be critical of are justified. Just give me a range. What do you think what does a board member of a large Fortune 500 company make a year? I'd like a student to guess.
Million four.
What board can you get me on that? Yeah. $1.4 million. No. Okay. You want, wait. Okay. Well. Yeah.
Maybe 200,000.
What? About two. It's 200,000 to 400,000 generally. Now, if the stock price does go up, that remuneration goes up. But most people, when I say that, are surprised. That's a lot of money, right? For like 15, 16 meetings a year. So can I tell you, I know you, I maybe hope you're starting to get that I'm kind of a real leftist. So if you're making $300,000 a year, right, for, you know, isn't the hardest job in the world, you think you're really likely to raise hell in the board meeting? You think everybody say, excuse me, Mr. Chairman, that's the stupidest damn idea I ever heard. What happens in a board meeting when you do that? Huh? They come and have a private continuous improvement chat with you. And they say things like, yeah, you know, you don't exactly understand. We've been doing it this way. And I say, yeah, but it's a really stupid idea. I don't agree with it. They say, yeah, but you know, Kurt, we like to have unanimity at the board. We like our board members to agree with each other. We don't like conflict. And incidentally, did I mention to you that you made $340,000 last year on this board? So why don't you think about it? We're going to go back in the room and we're going to try the vote again. Okay, I'm making this up a little bit, but not so much. Okay, another thing to look at is reliability of financial reporting. Have you heard of a company called Valiant?
Yes.
Seen it been in the news lately? So reliability of financial reporting is very important because it's the true accounting for how an organization is doing. And the vast majority of corporations do a fabulous job at that. But would you believe me if I told you that there are some corporations that overtly, intentionally misrepresent their financials? Would you believe me? Nod. Go ahead. You don't have to talk. You can nod. Yes, I believe. No, I don't believe. I can't imagine anybody doing that. Well, then they get caught, as did Valiant, and then you know what they have to do? Restate their earnings. So reliability of financial reporting is important. risk management and internal controls. This is where, as you know, because of your senior position, this is where a great deal of criticism came to some of the largest banks in 2008. They mismanaged risk. They mismanaged risk. And so how a corporation manages risk, where it's done, and it should be done at the full board, is important. Okay, shareholder rights and responsibilities. Okay, all corporations in their proxy statements talk about shareholder rights and responsibilities. But not all corporations actually act on those. Here's the one that I find, I've had good experiences and really terrible experiences. Corporations should be looked at from the vantage point of how they enhance and accept social responsibility. So, you know, I spent most of my career at DuPont. Was a great company. Okay? DuPont is now merging with Dow and moving most of their operations out of the state of Delaware. Everybody know where Delaware is? It's south of New Jersey. You know, sometimes you go, you're on the train and you look out the window and you go, okay. So here's the problem, folks. When I was CFO at DuPont, there were 25,000 people in Delaware. And how many there are now? 4,000. Think what that does to the state of Delaware. I hope you agree that the board of directors has a social responsibility to its employees. The board of directors has a social responsibility to its communities. The board of directors has more than just a responsibility to drive shareholder value, folks. So maybe by now you're saying, wow, how did this guy ever get on 5 boards? God. Well, first of all, take a look at me, right? Do I look like I'm some kind of flaming? No. I look like somebody's grandfather. Okay? I was the CFO at DuPont. I was the chief operating officer at DuPont. On paper, they all say, hey, he's going to be what?
One of us.
Just like us. It isn't until I get on that they find out that I have slightly different views, and some companies like that and some do not. Okay, so let's go down my checklist, and I'll open up the questions. First thing you want to look at is how are boards selected? When elected, how are they selected? We all know how they get. You ever seen, you know, if a board member doesn't get 98% of the shareholder vote, they consider resigning. Okay, I'm going to ask another question. This one always amazes me. I know, Bob, you know. If I'm standing for the election on a corporate board, and I get 47% of the shareholder vote, what happens? What do you think? How many of you think I will be asked to resign? One. Huh?
You're asked to leave?
I could be asked to leave. I could ask, you think that's what happened? Here's, you know what actually happens? This one always startles people. Shareholder votes are advisory. Did you know that?
No.
Shareholder votes are advisory. Whether they be for the stockholders or whether they be on pay for performance, any of those shareholder proposals, the vote is advisory. Now, often, you know, a good company, if I got 48% of the vote, the chairman would come and say, or the chairwoman would come and say, you didn't get a majority, we'd like you to resign. Right? But that doesn't happen all the time. It doesn't, as a matter of fact, I would even say it happens infrequently, because it's very rare that shareholders get less than 50% of the vote. But watch what happens when that occurs. Shareholder votes are advisory. And you've seen some very notable cases where the shareholders vote to do A, and the board says, thank you for your input. We prefer to do B. I can see the look on your face. You don't believe me. I promise you it's true. It happens. It doesn't happen all the time, but it happens. look at the compensation of the board and the management team. Who sets the compensation of the senior management? Compensation committee of the board. Who sets the compensation of the board? Who? Come on, please talk to me. The senior management. So, compensation committee of the board sets senior management salary and bonus, and the board and the senior management decides on how much the board gets. Does that sound equitable? Does it sound real? Yeah, it's real. Take it from me. I've been on. Okay. Risk orientation and tone at the top. You know what tone at the top is? Ever hear that term? Anybody ever say that? Yeah. Tone at the top. Tone at the top means I can say one thing, but I can make it clear to you I actually mean another. You know how you do that? Well, I can say, we're in this for the long term. We're investing in you. I used to work for Upjohn. They say, Upjohn begins with you. It did until they sold out to Pfizer. Okay? The tone at the top is not what senior executives say. It's what they do. So I'm going to assure you something, and you're going to say, this is a very cynical character. If I said to the CEO of most American companies, you will be compensated by the number of pumpkins you have in your garage on Halloween, I can guarantee you that every Fortune 500 CEO in America would have a garage full of pumpkins. I guarantee it, because you get what you ask for and what you compensate for. The other thing to look at is board defense systems. You talk about that in your class? So how do boards protect themselves? Well, they put all kinds of stuff in. You know, I'm from Delaware. So they all incorporate in Delaware, which we like. You know, gives us some, right? And they put in things called a poison pill. What's that? Do you know what that is? Have you heard that term? What's a poison pill? A poison pill protects the company and a board against a hostile takeover. There's all kinds of components to that, but they do that to make sure that if they are not subject to the will of an outside inappropriate influence that they don't want to be. They do classify. What's the difference between a classified board and a normal board, you know? Classified boards are in many companies use this. See, one of the great risks from an activist is to have all of your board members eligible to be re-elected in the same year. How come? What's happening at Yahoo? You know, you all know Yahoo, right? Some of you are on it right now. What's happening at Yahoo? There's an activist investor who said that he is going to take and replace all the board members. One way to stop that is not have all your board members elected in the same year. You know, I don't know exactly, you would probably, I don't know what percent of companies have classified, you know, class boards, and what percent have an open election every year. But a lot of outside pressure has caused boards to change. It used to be that almost all boards were classified. Directors were elected for 3-year terms, and that stops what? It stops the wholesale removal of a board. Okay. Talked about the chairman, president, and CEO. If I was king, I'm not. I would tell you that having the chairman, the president, and the CEO in one position is not a good thing. There needs to be a check and balance for the board to be effective. You know this because we just talked about it. Look where they domicile their tax location. You know this thing about the Panama Papers? So all these people from outside of the United States are in all kind of trouble. The Prime Minister of Iceland resigned. See, when you're retired, you have all kind of time to watch TV. So why is there very few people from the United States there? You know what? There are very few people being identified who are U.S. citizens in the Panama Papers.
They're using Delaware.
Because we don't need to do it here. We just got to go to Wyoming, Delaware, and we can set up all kind of tax havens. So you want to look at the domicile of a company. Transparency. Does the board and the management tell truth? Do they tell you the truth? Or do they tell you what you want to hear only to be found out later. Lastly, look at their performance. And I don't mean performance just in terms of stock price and those. Look at their performance in the social matrix. What do they do? And then I got to tell you, boards, if they're going to stop the criticism, need to care about diversity, equality, and value orientation. Diversity, equality, and a value orientation. Not the movement of stock prices day to day, week to week, quarter to quarter. How do you know if a company is doing that, folks? Yeah, how do you think? Well, you watch what they do. Who do they hire? Who do they promote? Are how many people of color, how many women are on the board? How many people in positions of high responsibility are non-white males who have been at the company for years and years? Okay, so why is there so much criticism, folks? Why is this? Right, you agree that this has been unbelievable criticism toward corporations, right? The Republicans, the Democrats, they're all alike in one thing. Phenomenally critical about the role of American corporations in destroying America. I'm going to tell you that American corporations make America, I was going to say make America great, but I'm going to hold off my corporations make America the place that it is. We hire lots of people. We create value. Why are we so criticized? Well, for one thing, it's lack of societal engagement. Very few people from corporations are willing to step forward and come in front of public groups. Why? Why is it?
Is he a target?
Yeah, who said that? Yeah, that's right. Because they become a target. It's no fun. They become a target. They get criticized. They have to be more transparent. Lack of societal, closely held boards. Do I know what that is? What's a closely held board? Anybody here ever work for a family-owned corporation? Like DuPont, Corning? Okay, closely held boards are controlled very often by the family. There's some good and there's some not so good in that. Look at closely held boards. From the top, we talked about a clueless management. Tone deaf. They don't get it. They don't understand the environment that they're operating in. They're tone deaf. And then when they get nailed to stop the inversion, they act like they can't hardly believe it. How could you not know that you weren't going to be allowed to move to Ireland? Turn on the TV, folks, he said. I don't think Pfizer's ever going to ask me to go on their board. Short-term orientation, inappropriate compensation schemes, lots of societal political anger. You see that in the elections. You know, let's be frank, folks. There's lots of technological changes which are causing corporations to have to deal with different things. That's a reality. There's developed a 1 versus 99% mindset. You see it played out in our political structure. And what, frankly, and I can tell you, I think that boards are now subject to political opportunism. We are a really popular target. American corporations are popular targets. Because guess what? Most people aren't on the boards of directors. Most people are not capitalists. They have not done well in the economy. So they think it's whose fault? Corporations. Okay, so what must we do? Okay, I'm going to say effective transparency, open board membership to constituent boards. Select the CEO based upon your value system. Honest, direct, corporate, responsible behavior. Operate in the best interest of democracy and the Constitution. So that ain't been happening so much. But here's what I think you can expect. Intensified regulation. Intensified political rhetoric. Social distrust, is any of this that you believe any of this stuff is not happening?
It's already happening.
Social distrust, people distrust American corporations to say that General Electric is behaving in a criminal way, that's what was said by one of the political candidates, you know that, right? Unbelievable, General Electric, one of the great American corporations that does everything correct and right, in my view. So the last thing that's happening, folks, and then I'll stop and take your questions, is as a result of all of the above, we have a new phenomenon in America. It's called activist investors. These are people who take gigantic positions in corporations, and they do that because they want to change the trajectory of the corporation, often from longer term to shorter term. There is nothing that scares a corporate board more than an activist investor. Nothing scares them more. I don't think I've ever been on a board that doesn't spend one board meeting going through the same stuff over and over again, what we're going to do when the activist investor knocks on the door. Why are we so afraid of that? Why was DuPont so afraid of it? Because activist investors care about only one thing. Not all, but most. What do they care about?
Short-term
results. They don't care about strategy, they don't care about culture, they don't care about the employees, they don't care about constituency, they don't care about the state. They don't care about anything other than creating a short-term gain at the expense of longer-term corporate strategy. So, with that sort of diatribe, that's what I believe. Been there, seen good boards, seen not so good boards, seen the results of that is societal inadequacy. And now what I'm watching is corporations being blamed for most of America's ills. And I think it's because corporations have not been responsive to social needs. So with that, I will take your questions. Yes, sir.
I have one question. I'm confused in the way you can hear.
No.
Thank you. I was confused when you spoke about corporate board, the major corporate, how much they earn. And you used the term fee.
Directors.
And you used the term fee. And then you went to compensation. Would you agree that fee and compensation are two different things?
No.
All right. So then in the fee, I also followed you and said stock options, stock awards. That's not in the fee. So if you add the three together, it was more than $200,000.
That's the total compensation.
Yeah.
Yeah. What I'm suggesting to you, opinion, is fees and stock awards are a good thing. Fees because that's how you get really good people on the board. Stock awards because it puts you in the same place as the shareholders for long-term interest. Options are not. Options are short-term oriented. And I think that drives corporate behavior in a very negative way.
Yeah, that's not my question. My question was the compensation.
Yeah.
The compensation of a major
yeah.
board member,
yeah.
counting the three, is approximately how much?
Well, it depends on the size of the company, but
major
company. $200,000 to $400,000.
That's all?
Yes.
Yeah.
That's
all.
No wonder I'm not on any corporate boards.
Well, yeah, I mean, that's a lot of money, folks. That's a lot of money.
Can I ask a question?
You can.
You talk about now in options, people know options. Options for a reason. Options for a reason were a tax advantage or disadvantage because options were made to be a maximum of 9 months, maybe less than a year because of the long term. But most corporate directors, don't they have long-term leaps or warrants as opposed to short-term 9-month options?
Well, normally an option doesn't vest for a year. That the boards I've been on, you have a 1-year vesting of the option.
Right, you can't do anything until it vests.
You vest for a year, but after that, you can do what you want.
No, I understand that, but these options, you can do anything you want, but these options are longer term, though. You can have an option for 5 or 10 years.
Or 20 years.
So the point is that it's not a short term. It's the way the CEOs present.
But it's regular income.
Yeah, it depends on what the director does. Right? If I get a 20-year option and I exercise it in 2 years, that's a short term option. If I hold it for 20 years, that's a good thing.
Why would you hold it?
Why wouldn't you hold it?
Yeah, why give up the option value by exercising in 2 years when you have a free option ride for another 18?
Well, that's a great question, especially from you, Bob, because you know the answer to that. That's why people in the investment community look carefully at insider transactions. They look, you know, if you, for those of you who are on Yahoo now, go into a company, go into the Yahoo Finance page. One of the things that investment people look at all the time is insider transactions. They're looking to see which management teams and which boards are selling their stock, because that tells you why they're doing it, because of what Bob just said. They don't think it's going to be much higher. Watch what happens when a management team or a board begins to divest their stock or options. The investment community follows along.
Kurt, I also want to tell you, I did not get that question from my daughter, who's in the M&A department at Pfizer.
I know you would have answered it correctly. Yes, ma'am.
You've talked about the compensation of a board member. What are the legal implications and protections that a board member might need?
So all boards offer D&O insurance, usually pretty substantial, to protect you against shareholder suits, protect you against fiduciary. I was on a board that went bankrupt, and we needed every penny of that D&O insurance, because if they go bankrupt, we were sued by everybody known to mankind. You get D&O insurance, usually very, very high, hundreds of millions of dollars generally, so you're protected against that. And then frankly, folks, and I don't know if you agree with this, but the way our corporate system is set up, you know, again, boards are not bound to do the right thing. They're not. They're bound to do what they believe is in the best interest of the corporation. So it's very difficult, I don't know if you're an attorney, but it's very difficult if you're an attorney to say to a board member, well, why did you do this? It was wrong. And they say, yeah, maybe it was, but I thought it was in the best interest of the corporation at the time.
I have a comment. This is not an American phenomenon. We can look at a major world-class corporation that made a decision at the very highest level to do something that they maybe thought would help in the total production, total revenue, total shareholder value, but totally blew up in their face, and that's Volkswagen.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, that's Volkswagen.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah, and so I don't know what, you know what he's talking about? So Volkswagen basically put into its emission control systems an IT system that any time the car was being tested for its emissions would kick in and would give a faulty output. What do you call that?
Fraud.
What is it?
Fraud.
It's fraud. It's morally corrupt. How do you defend it? How can you defend doing that? You know they did it on purpose. We don't want to spend the money to do the right thing on emission control, but you know what? We can fool those dumb regulators. We'll put this cool system in place. Go in and test me, and I'll give you a little.
I think the point also to make is that, you know, it's a cultural thing. If the same thing happened at Toyota, yeah, it would have been a totally different response. And Volkswagen was like, oh, you caught us. Yeah. Keep going.
That's the tone at the top.
I guess I'd have to agree with Don. The response was unbelievable. They fired the CEO, but very few other changes occurred until they started to see what happened. Then other countries started to check it out, and then when it got close to home, like Germany, then they decided they better do something about it. Yeah, that's one of those most egregious examples of corrupt. And where was the board? Where was the senior management? Who were they? Don't tell me that the CEO of the company didn't know that. Please don't tell me that. Maybe the board didn't, but the CEO knew. You're right. What else would you like to do? Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir.
Yeah, I would add one other, a fourth factor about America. The three things you said make America great, and that is the rule of law. Because you're going to have a written constitution. You know, the Soviet Union had a written constitution. Lots of countries had a written constitution. So I think the rule of law, I would add a rule of law to your list. Secondly, while with the nominal corporate rate is about 35% tax rate, as I understand it, very few companies pay the nominal rate.
Yeah. But you know why, right? Just, I didn't mean to interrupt you, but you know why? Because they find a way.
They find a way to cut the rate.
To offshore their cash.
Well, that's
even
part of
it. Even the best companies, even the companies that I would hold up as corporate icons, do it.
Right.
Apple, Corning. They find a way to offshore their cash so they don't have to.
But that's not the only. I think there are other tax strategies that you can use.
There are lots of them.
To reduce your actual tax rate. But I think, I don't remember precisely, but I think the average corporate tax rate that I recall reading about was some, more in the range of about 12 to 15%, something like that, which, you know, if you say the nominal rate is 35 and you compare it to other countries, you've got to look behind that, I think, and see how much they're actually paying in other countries. That's,
no, I agree. But why has there been this big push in the last couple of years for tax for inversions?
Why, well, inversion, because Ireland, the tax rate is extremely low.
Yeah, but not just Ireland, right? Why in the last couple of years has this become a big issue? What are corporations beginning to fear? They're beginning to fear that the deficit in the United States is getting so large that the legislature, the Congress of the United States, is going to turn to American corporations to pay down the deficit and further burden corporations with high taxes. So they're looking for ways to get out.
Our deficit as a percentage of our gross national product is lower than it's been in quite a while.
I don't know. You have to talk to some of the people running for office. I don't really disagree with you, but I think it's become a national political structure. Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am.
Earlier when you spoke about risk management and internal control, you said that a lot of companies mismanage risk, which led to the crisis in 2008. My question is, like, what are the main effects that you see, like, that happened immediately right after the board realizes that they've mismanaged risk?
I couldn't hear you. I apologize.
Mismanaging risk.
What happens when they mismanage risk?
Yeah. What does the board realize, like, immediately right after they realize that happens?
Well, I'll give you one that a lot of the boards are realizing is that they don't understand. They didn't believe that cybersecurity was important. Didn't spend any money on cybersecurity, information technology, and then one day they wake up and find out that the Chinese have all of their industrial secrets. So what happens when the board does that? It's a fire drill. People panic. What happens in the pharmaceutical company? So I spent most of my career in the pharmaceutical industry. Risk management is extraordinarily important. What happens if they mismanage that? Well, I've seen companies that have put products on the market only to find out that, you know, that there are toxic, that they hurt people, that they are, that they cause bodily harm. And what happens? The boards go crazy, and
is
they do the right things.
Is that because they're liable for that?
Huh?
Is that because they're liable for that?
Actually, believe it or not, that's what I thought. It's because they're actually pretty good people. Mm-hmm. Nobody wants to be on a corporate board that does intentionally wrong things. The reason that they don't pick it all up is they don't pay close enough attention.
So it's not intentional at all.
You know, it's like, you know this, any generic statement is always, there's always an exception. I don't think the corporate boards in general set out to do the wrong thing. I think they set out to do the right thing. It's just that I'm not sure that they always do.
Say, Kurt, another example is Lehman Brothers did not manage risk properly. There is no longer a Lehman Brothers. The shareholders lost all of their money,
yep.
And all of the executives lost every penny of their options.
Absolutely. Right, Bob. I mean, there are lots of examples of it. Yes, ma'am.
I don't have a question, but I have a kind of an optimistic comment to make, because I am a female director of a bank board. I was elected 15 years ago. And I knew I was the token woman. I did not have a financial background. I was a special education teacher. But I have to say that in these 15 years, there's been a tremendous increase in diversity, transparency, and openness to the management listening to the board. We're not totally there yet. We still have chairman and CEO combined. But I really feel that some of the things that you've mentioned, they're on their way to a greater degree of
What, may I ask you why you think that's occurring? Because I agree with you, there's been tremendous change in the last 10 years.
Well, I would have to say the second board member was a woman. The second woman that came on the board is very strong. And I think that opened a lot of eyes to the possibility that a woman could really, you know, have a good idea. I lent my whatever I could. Actually, I came back to Wagner and took accounting courses because I really, after Enron and WorldCom, it became necessary to at least be able to fulfill my fiduciary responsibility. But I feel when you're speaking, there are lots of things to criticize, but I think we're going in the right direction.
I think we're going absolutely in the right direction, but I would also tell you, my opinion is the reason for that, the society is changing and requiring
that
boards do, that's what shareholders, you know, that's why there are these shareholder proposals.
We are much more answerable.
Hey, boards are much more answerable, and they know that, and remember, there are groups that measure the performance of boards.
Right.
And they send out a letter every year saying, elect this one, don't elect this one. Right? They comment on it, on board transparency. They comment on compensation. So boards are no longer to do, they're no longer able to do pretty much what they want. They're accountable.
But I really feel that management has had to change its attitude about the board just going along with everything. I feel, at least from my experience, our management, the culture has totally changed to the board being able to express its true feelings and not being intimidated, as I think it was 15 years ago.
All three corporate boards that I'm on right now are phenomenally responsible and responsive to their boards.
Mine is too.
Unbelievable.
I think ours is too.
But you see, here's the problem. If let's say that 90% of all boards do the right thing, want to do the right thing, it's the 10% that do things that are inappropriate, illegal, immoral, unconstitutional, whatever. That's where the negativity toward American corporations comes from. It's that small group of people who don't understand their role in the societal matrix. But I agree with you. Most boards are phenomenal.
No, I just feel when hearing you talk, I feel very secure in our board and the ability to have that transparency.
Right. And I would bet you that the chairperson of your board is a big factor in why your board feels so listened to and valued.
Yes, you're absolutely right.
I agree completely with you.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
I just wanted to second that because I'm on a few boards and I work with my corporate board, and I've seen that there's a big focus on also getting the right skill sets on the boards now. That for things like cybersecurity, real estate problems, I mean the skill sets now, the boards are demanding that those skills come on the boards because we can't be good board members if we don't have people with the expertise to challenge what's going on within the company.
Absolutely agree, but I think it's all happening in the context of a societal matrix that's requiring the change.
That's right. Well, and I'm just interested in your thoughts on what's happening in Europe where board members now can be held criminally liable.
As someone here, I think, alluded to, theoretically, board members in the United States can be held criminally liable.
That's true. It's fraud.
Kurt, but what is a DNR? What is DNO?
Yeah.
Oh, you said that. DNO.
Directors and officers.
Oh, directors and officers insurance.
DNO.
All corporates. DNO. Sorry. It's all corporations. You wouldn't go on a board without it. I mean, unless you're dumb. You wouldn't go on it because then all your personal, all your personal wealth is at the risk of DNO, and you have to have it.
Sierra.
Just because I'm holding the microphone right now, I have two questions. Do you think that this severe lack of trust in corporations is warranted by the public? And also, did corporations experience this before 2008 to this degree, at least?
Okay, well, first off, I hope I didn't say that I don't trust American corporations.
But the public obviously doesn't.
Do I think that the distrust is warranted? I understand your point. I would say that it's probably okay to have to be a little skeptical about corporations, to hold them to higher societal standards. And, you know, I'm not the best person to answer this. You would be, and I think maybe you would. I think it's intensified significantly since 2008, because American corporations, especially banks, were held responsible for what became known as the Great Recession. And the political environment right now, it's corporations have become the target of much antagonism, and it seems to be populist. Seems to be very popular, right?
Can I add something?
Sure.
Sarah, you get the ebb and flow of what happens, and I think probably the single most egregious act that ever happened in this country was Enron and Arthur Andersen. There you had people that trusted everybody, trusted Arthur Andersen to give you the right stuff, and then Enron, which totally took, you know, abused everything. But what happens then, and Kurt, you can talk about this, politicians get involved. And what came out of Enron was SOX, Sarbanes-Oxley, which was one of the worst things that Congress could pass as far as the competitiveness of the United States vis-a-vis the world. In fact, we saw countless companies not being listed in the United States going to London because in SOX, and we have Dr. Horan here to correct if I'm wrong, the CEO could be personally liable.
That's right.
For something that happens fraudulently 15 levels below him. And the Europeans are no dopes. They could go over and be listed in the London Stock Exchange and not have that. So here we have the politicians exacerbating the fraud, basically, by taking it too far the other way. We're talking, of course, now we're going to talk about Dodd and Frank and their relationships to what happened. Frank was very close to Fannie Mae, and Dodd was very close to all the insurance companies that were in his state. So these things happen, they get carried to an extreme, the government gets involved and makes it worse, and then we swing back the other way. And then it loosens up and it takes 8 more years.
So, phenomenal, okay. Do you remember how I started, you know, 3 hours ago? I said there are three foundational systems. Capitalism, democracy. Democracy is what we're witnessing. That's, you know, voting and primate democracy. And what you correctly point out, I say the Constitution, Bill of Rights, I think your terminology is more accurate, is rule of law. And then where I said, if any of those three get out of equilibrium, that's when the country begins to falter. And it's not just America. And what's happened in my opinion, and it's only that, is what we witnessed, you know, over the past 10 years or so, is that democracy, capitalism, and the rule of law have lost their normal equilibrium weighting in how society views things. And I'm really worried, in case you can't tell. I'm really worried. And frankly, at great risk, I'm going to tell you something. I think that the current political environment is real, no matter who you're for, no matter who you believe in, the degree of vitriol, the degree of viciousness, the degree of personal attack is just absolutely concerning from an American point of view. That's the Corning chairman, he wants to talk to me. Yes, ma'am.
I was happy in the Q&A when I think you sort of clarified something that I had misunderstood from your remarks when you said that you thought at least 90% of corporate America is doing right and it's a small percentage that's doing wrong. So I really am glad that came up in Q&A because from your earlier remarks, I was worried you thought it was a much higher percentage than I certainly think. And maybe another point of confusion that I wanted to ask you to clarify is you sounded like you were negative on the concept of poison pills. And I believe that poison pills' purpose, if used properly, is to protect the corporation for the long term away from short-sighted investor coming in. So did I misunderstand you? Because you sounded like you were negative on the concept of poison pills.
Well, I kind of am, no.
Well, then if you are against poison pills, then why? Because that's in conflict with long-term thinking.
Yeah, thank you for the question, because it's, you know, poison pills are very complex. It isn't just one, as you know, it isn't just one thing. When poison pills are used to keep short-term, in, like an activist investor, from coming in and wreaking havoc against the corporate environment, I am all for that. I think it's phenomenal. I don't think I've ever been on a corporation board that doesn't have some form of a poison pill. It's when they are used to basically say to the constituent groups that they're responsible to, thanks for your input, but we're going to do this anyway, our way, no matter what you say. Poison pills in and of themselves are not bad, but if they're used inappropriately, I think they're wrong.
Understood.
Thank you.
We have one more, just one more. Let me hear it in the back.
Yeah, hi.
Hi, how are you? Just a quick question. You're saying a leftist. I'm from the financial industry. I work as a research executive, and I normally speak to people from the right side. You know what I mean? I've never been able to ask questions to the person from the left. Now, why do you think inside the current elections, there's so much hatred against Wall Street? Everyone knows that without us, a huge majority of the U.S. economy would collapse, and they're currently going after us, you know, in every which way, including taking away commissions and such. What, from the left side view, makes such a hatred against us when we all know there were SROs in place, you know, FINRA was formed in 07, you know, we had the SEC, so 08 was not completely because of Wall Street, it could have been prevented. What is your view on that?
Well, first of all, the fact that you think I'm a leftist.
Well, you opened up saying you're on the left side of the spectrum, so.
I tend to be left-leaning moderate.
Use the mic.
I tend to be left-leaning moderate. Okay, you're right. The answer to your question is that Wall Street has been the dominant corporate structure, and corporations have been the dominant target for political pandering that is bringing together much of the hatred, inequality sense, of all the things that people are afraid of in this society. They're directing that angst against Wall Street and corporations. Donnie, what would you say?
Look, anybody, first of all, you have to realize one thing. I always tell my wife, to say, all politicians, pardon my French, are totally full of shit. If you listen to anything they say, you're being foolish. They're feeding whatever wants to be fed. And, you know, whether it's Bernie Sanders, the silent majority of people are yelling about because of student loans, or it's Trump talking about whatever he wants to talk about, and then you have in the middle. The only one that makes any sense to me is Kasich, really, and he's very boring. But the truth of the matter is that you have to, you know, listen, Romney was totally right, but didn't know how to express himself, okay? So you have to go back, like, spend 3-4 hours or an entire semester, which I'm doing right now, explaining this whole thing that happened in 2008 that started back in the 60s and just built and built and built and built and built. So it's obvious, as Kurt said, that Wall Street's an easy target. They're an easy target. And a lot of the stuff that's happened, I would go so far to say that 98, maybe 99% of all corporations do the right thing. Maybe it's only 1% that don't. And that's because maybe they have a stronger alpha CEO that pushes it that way. But Wall Street happened, you know, the movies like The Wolf of Wall Street and Wall Street and Gordon Gekko. Gordon Gekko is no much different from Carl Icahn. And that's what's happening right now with activists moving in there. And everybody's trying to make another buck. So let's go back to the Volkswagen thing for one quick second. Volkswagen probably did everything in their power they could do to be number one in the world legally. Foreign exchange rates of the pigs holding down the euro helped them tremendously. The next step to go, they had to break the law. The next step from Lehman to go was go that one more step because Dick Folk wanted more returns and they bought something they shouldn't have bought and they were over leveraged. So there's no new tricks, they're just new tricksters. Wall Street is easy to hit now. You know, but without Wall Street, you don't have any capital formation at all. Without corporations, as Winston Churchill once said about democracy, the worst thing in the world until you see everything else, that's exactly it. This will pass, it's election fervor, and you know, Wall Street has really shrunk a lot since 2008, but it's mostly because of technology and everything else.
So here's a, I'm going to close with a leftist comment. The most important thing for American corporations, democracy, and the rule of law to concentrate on is income inequality. Unless we do something to stop the vast divide of income inequality, you're going to have a growing underclass that will do nothing but harm to the country. And I could prove that to you if I had another hour. It's gotten worse and worse and worse, with fewer and fewer people having more and more money and more people being left out of the equation. That's when societies have trouble. Corporations get the blame for that, but it's not corporations that are doing it necessarily. It's a whole variety of factors. That's the single most important thing that needs to change in our society, in my leftward leaning view.
Thank you.
Hold on a second, please. We have a little gift.
That picture.
So this is a token of our pleasure, gratitude, appreciation for your participation in the Presidential Summit to Kurt Landgraf, 2068 honorary 08, April 11, 2000.
Thank you.